We have big Disneyland news this week. Soon you won't have to live in California to visit the West Coast parks. Plus ride openings and closures. What's going on with park capacity in Disney World? And our least favorite Dole Whip flavor is back for some redemption.
Along with some major mask news.
It's all coming up right now on DFB Guide. Hey everybody, it's AJ for Disney Food Blog. We have a lot of very important Disneyland news to cover this week, including the fact that they somehow keep getting more and more virtual queues for rides while Disney World still only has the one. And if you're an ear collector, Disney released a few new ones this week that I know you're going to need to add to your collection. We got a lot to cover, so let's get started. All right, we have got no more masks in Universal Studios Orlando. Beginning today, May 29th, Universal Orlando, face masks will no longer be required indoors for fully vaccinated guests. When combined with Universal's current outdoor mask policy, this means face coverings will be optional everywhere on property. While Universal states that this policy only applies to fully vaccinated guests, proof of vaccination will not be required, so it will be an honor system when deciding whether or not to wear a mask indoors. The language on social distancing has been altered as well. Guests are now encouraged to keep a safe distance instead of stay 3 feet apart. As of this time, Disney World has not updated their mask or social distancing policies further, which currently only allow guests to remove masks while outdoors. But if timelines follow the previous mask updates, Disney World may follow suit and align their mask policies with what Universal Orlando has implemented. This could happen at any time.
Disneyland is gonna open to those out-of-state visitors. Since they reopened in April, only California residents have been able to visit the resort, but things are changing. Disneyland will open to out-of-state guests beginning June 15th. These visitors are not required to be vaccinated, but the state of California does recommend vaccination or a negative COVID-19 test.
Masks will still be required at all times, except when actively eating or drinking while stationary. And out-of-state guests can begin booking their trips now, but cannot enter the parks before June 15th. We've also got a virtual queue for Web Slingers. Of course, Avengers Campus will be officially opening on June 4th, and the new ride in the land, Web Slingers, a Spider-Man adventure, will not be offering a standby line. Instead, you'll need to join a virtual queue. The virtual queue will function just like the one for Rise of the Resistance. You'll be able to join at 7 a.m. and 12 p.m. daily using the Disneyland app, and you'll be able to enter the queue once per day. If you have a park pass reservation for Disney California Adventure, you'll be able to join your boarding group at 7 a.m. from outside of the park or 12 p.m. Guests who have a park pass reservation for Disneyland Park with a park hopper ticket may join the virtual queue at 12 p.m. as long as you've already entered Disneyland Park that day. Remember, you can park hop starting at 1 p.m. in Disneyland each day. When it's your turn to ride, you'll get a notification from the Disneyland app letting you know that your group's return time was called and you'll have an hour to return to the ride. One big thing to note though, you can't have a boarding group for Rise of the Resistance and Web Slingers at the same time. We'll be testing out how the system works and how to up your chances of riding both rides, so stay tuned to DFB Guide and DisneyFoodBlog.com. All right, Jungle Cruise in both Disneyland and Disney World is getting some updates to introduce new characters and remove negative cultural stereotypes. The Disney World version remains open while the changes are taking place, but Disneyland has opted to keep the ride closed until everything is complete. Now, Disney's announced that everything is going to be complete in mid-July, and the ride will officially reopen on July 16th. Over in Disney World, that new end scene that's replacing the Trader Sam animatronic has started to be installed. Stay tuned to see what it looks like when it's officially unveiled. But another Disneyland ride will be closing. The Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh has been added to the refurbishment calendar beginning July 5th. Disney's not announced the scope of the refurbishment or how long it will last. It could be for some quick touch-ups or some more intensive work. We just don't know yet, but we'll keep you updated with the latest info. Until we know, better get over to Critter Country quickly to ride by July 5th. And July is gearing up to be a big month in Disneyland, but park hours are being extended to hopefully help you fit everything into your schedule. Starting July 1st, Disneyland Park will be open for one extra hour in the morning and in the evening, 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. Disney California Adventure will open 1 hour earlier at 8 a.m. and Downtown Disney will add an hour in the morning and the evening to be open from 8 a.m. to 11 p.m. Now, our last piece of Disneyland news this week, could Disneyland fully reopen next month? Well, June 15th isn't just the first day that out-of-staters can visit
Disneyland. It's also the day the entire state of California will fully reopen. That means that capacity and social distancing restrictions will be eliminated, even for large-scale events and gatherings, which includes theme parks. The state will be requiring vaccination records or negative test results for indoor mega events, though outside events, the category where Disneyland falls, will not need to follow that requirement, though it is recommended by the state. California will also align their mask guidelines with the CDC and allow fully vaccinated people to go maskless in most indoor settings. As of June 15th, Disneyland will end temperature checks for both guests and employees, and Disneyland has not commented on whether or not they will be increasing park capacity, removing social distancing guidelines, or relaxing mask requirements. But this is something that could change very quickly, like what we saw happen in Disney World. So stay up to date on all the latest information by signing up for our newsletter. The link is just below this video and in the description. All right, moving over to the East Coast, Disney World capacity will slowly increase. Park capacity is definitely increasing over in Disney World. Disney CEO Bob Chapek noted that the parks will see low double-digit increases in attendance in the next several months. He also shared that attendance can continue to increase as Disney is able to hire back more furloughed and laid-off cast members. And he hinted that Walt Disney World would likely reach full capacity toward the end of the year. Walt Disneyland Resort is much further down the curve, he said. We haven't heard any hard numbers tossed around besides the 35% capacity that was released a few months ago, but the parks have already increased beyond that. We will keep you posted. Another COVID-era theme park change is coming to an end as well. Relaxation stations are disappearing from Disney World. Since you can now decide not to wear masks while outside, many of the indoor and outdoor seating locations that allowed guests to remove their masks are being phased out. Several former locations still have seating, though the cast member attendant is no longer stationed in the area. Indoor locations like Akershus and Epcot and Pizzafari and Animal Kingdom are no longer open to guests. And some news not related to reopenings and CDC guidelines. Chip and Dale have a new meet and greet spot over by the Indiana Jones Epic Stunt Spectacular, and they're in their Rescue Rangers costumes. If you're in Hollywood Studios, definitely go check if they're out. Now, we've got some restaurant and snack news for you, of course, from Disney World. There are some new dishes at Lotus Blossom Cafe. The Epcot counter service in the China Pavilion has some new menu items. They now feature a char siu combo and a red bean ice float for Disney's A World of Voices, which celebrates Asian Pacific American Heritage Month. The char siu combo is a Cantonese-style barbecue pork served with steamed rice, egg roll, and broccoli for $13.50. It's a great bang-for-your-buck meal, but flavor-wise was a little hit or miss. And the red bean ice float is a Hong Kong-style dessert drink with sweetened Chinese red beans, milk, crushed ice, and vanilla ice cream, all for $8.95. This one mostly tastes like a vanilla milkshake with some extra chew from the red beans every so often. Now, these are likely limited-time eats, so don't be surprised if you don't see them on the menu a month or so from now. But the Flower and Garden Festival booth that's been changing out throughout the festival has gotten its newest menu. The Farmer's Feast booth has rotated their menu again, and it's time for summer. You'll find tomato and cornbread panzanella, barbecue seared pork tenderloin, and lemon ricotta cheesecake. And there's a new drink as well, the mango lemonade with Palm Ridge rye whiskey. Everything was very fresh, very tasty, and really good portion sizes, especially for festival eats. We have a full review over at DisneyFoodBlog.com, but we think these dishes are solid enough to add to your festival buy list. And Grand Floridian's Gasparilla Island Grill has a new strawberry shortcake for $5.99. The classic dessert is made with layers of fresh whipped cream, diced strawberries and strawberry coulis, and vanilla sponge cake. It certainly wasn't anything spectacular over the top. It was simple but delicious and definitely good for the summer. And Watermelon Dole Whip is back. Marketplace Snacks in Disney Springs is trying that Watermelon Dole Whip again. We were so excited to try this one back in January as it was the only flavor we haven't seen pop up at Disney World, but it did not really deliver. It was too bubblegummy and artificial tasting and we were just not into it, but we had to see if they could redeem this flavor. Well, the new Watermelon Dole Whip Parfait features Watermelon Dole Whip, key lime custard, chocolate chips, and a real watermelon in the shape of Mickey Mouse as a garnish on top for $5.29. And it still fell flat. The flavor is still artificial and too sweet. The chocolate chips were a little out of place and the custard is all the way on the bottom, so you've already finished your lackluster watermelon Dole Whip before you get to it. There's also a secret menu item here though, a watermelon slice, rind and all, filled with watermelon Dole Whip and topped with chocolate chips for $6.38. The Dole Whip is still not our favorite and the chocolate chips are still a little weird, but the watermelon slice did help. Neither of these are at the top of our snack lists by any means. beans, but if you like trying new Dole Whip creations and you really love watermelon, even in its fake form, or you gotta get that Instagram shot, then you can give these a go. All right, Everglaze Donuts in Disney Springs has a new coffee donut combo for $11. The Cloud 9 coffee has cold brew, milk, salted caramel syrup, and whipped cream, and it gets topped with that butterscotch caramel craze donut we told you about last week. The coffee is sweet, but not nearly as sweet as the caramel, butterscotch, and caramel corn-topped donut. They pair well together, but a serious sweet tooth is required. Everglazed will soon be offering mobile order through their website, so keep an eye out for that to skip the line. And it's time for a donut burger. You knew it would come eventually. Everglazed has a new donut burger, the B&G Burger. This is a burger with two patties of ground beef, American cheese, ketchup, mayo, lettuce, tomato, bread and butter pickles on a sweet bun. And for $1 extra, you can get it on a glazed donut. This thing is huge, messy, and really, really good. It's also a pretty good deal at $14, including the bun upcharge. And Vivalio Gelato is getting in on the Burger Day celebrations too. They got a Burger Lotto. This is a truffle brownie, cake batter gelato, strawberry sauce, and bacon inside an Italian donut for $11. The brownie overpowers nearly everything else in the dessert, but overall it was pretty tasty if you love brownies. Vivalio Gelato also has a new dessert celebrating Black Widow, the Scarlet Spider. It's made with cookies and cream gelato, milk, waffle cone, chocolate sauce, strawberry sauce, sprinkles, and whipped cream. Tasty, and it comes with a plastic spider ring for $15. Emirates Patisserie in Disney Springs has a new petite cake for the release of Cruella on Disney Plus. This $22 mini cake is decadent and made with vanilla chiffon cake and graham cake, with milk chocolate mousse and chocolate chip cookie dough, with a surprise red velvet layer that wasn't advertised on the sign. This was tasty and light, though we would have liked a little more cookie dough. If the cake is a little too much for you, stop by the ganachery for a cookies and cream ganache pop for $7. Now headed over into Savory, Morimoto Asia Street Food debuted a new buffalo chicken egg roll for $4. This thing was seriously tasty, but it's a limited time special, so get over there quickly if you want to try it. And The Market in Hollywood Studios has an interesting new popcorn flavor combo. The sweet and savory popcorn is a blend of caramel and cheddar popcorns for $7.50. This reminded us of those popcorn tins from around the holidays if you shook it up and mixed the flavors together. And I think I've seen a couple of these ideas in the grocery store as well. The combo sounds a little weird, but it was very good for those sweet and savory lovers. All right, we've got a Beaches and Cream milkshake swap for you. Don't worry, it's not a bad swap over at Beaches and Cream, but it was a little unexpected. Typically, those giant milkshakes are served in mason jar souvenir cups, but they've been swapped out for really big margarita glasses. These are the glasses they usually use over at Hurricane Hannah's for those giant, like, two-person drinks. Now, the manager we spoke with said they had production delays with the mason jars they typically use for the milkshakes, and they hope to have them back in a few weeks. In the meantime, the margarita glasses are definitely fun and have a certain I'm on vacation vibe to them. The cast member said they haven't heard any complaints. And the Polynesian Village Resort has some Memorial Day desserts. Captain Cook's has brought out the Memorial Day Cupcake, which is a vanilla cupcake with white chocolate mousse, buttercream icing, and blueberry compote swirl filling, topped with red, white, and blue sprinkles, blueberries, and raspberries for $5.99. This cupcake comes with a lot of filling and a lot of icing, at least ours did, almost a little too much, and it's a great balance of sweet and tart, but that white chocolate flavor is very strong. And at Pineapple Lanai, also at the Polynesian Village Resort, you can get the Firecracker Cone for $5.29. This is an upside-down cone filled with raspberry Dole Whip and topped with star sprinkles and popping candy. Raspberry Dole Whip is always a winner for us, and the popping candy added some extra fun to this otherwise pretty standard snack. In Disneyland, Blue Bayou has reopened and now serves alcohol for the first time in the restaurant's history. This is a big deal, as it's the first restaurant to open to the general public in the park to sell alcohol. Oga's Cantina and Galaxy's Edge were the first lounge to do so, and you can also get drinks at the exclusive Club 33 and Nouveau Lounge. Now, they're only seating around 11 tables right now at Blue Bayou, and nearly all of them are along the water. The menu is a bit smaller than what it used to be, but now you can also get beer, wine, or a hurricane cocktail with your meal. This is a departure from the alcohol rules in Magic Kingdom and Disney World, in that you can get liquor at a restaurant. We have a full review of our experience here over at DisneyFoodBlog.com. Over in Disney California Adventure, one more piece of Disneyland news. You'll be able to get some Avengers Campus Eats outside of the land. Shawarma Palace 2 is a mini kiosk near Hyperion Theater that will serve up some of the same eats as the main location. Now, this is great if you're craving shawarma and there's a long line at the Avengers Campus location. And Sprinkles reopens in Downtown Disney. Yep, your favorite cupcake spot in Disneyland has officially reopened on May 24th. The location had previously and unexpectedly closed back in January. You can place pre-orders online or stop by the store. All right, you ready for the merchandise news? We've got some new mini ears to tell you about this week. First up, the latest team up between Disney and Bauble Bar. The Bauble Bar blush mini ears feature a pleated pink bow and ears covered in rhinestones and pearls. We spotted these beauties at Fantasy Fair in the Magic Kingdom and at Gateway Gifts in Epcot for $44.99. They are popular and maybe tough to find. Next up are the studded rainbow ears with a multicolored pleated bow and navy velvet ears with multicolored rhinestones. We found them for $29.99 in Rock Around the Shop. That's the Rock and Roller Coaster gift shop. And Loki fans, there's a new pair of ears just for you. They're green mouse ears that feature Loki's iconic horned helmet and some gold stripes. You can find these ears at the Emporium in Magic Kingdom for $29.99. Marvel fans can also pick up a new Alex and Ani bracelet. The Alex and Ani Avengers bangle features a charm with the Avengers A surrounded by mini infinity stones. The Captain America bangle features Captain America's shield, and both are $44.99. And the Stitch Crashes Pinocchio collection is selling fast. Seems like this one may have finally hit its stride. The latest Pinocchio edition is selling out quickly. The plush and Magic Band were flying off the shelves in Disney World, though we're still awaiting the arrival of the pin in this collection. And some new Flower and Garden Festival merchandise has just appeared in Epcot, including new mugs with either Spike the Bee or Orange Bird for $19.99. There are also two new Orange Bird t-shirts and a new Orange Bird hoodie. We found this new merchandise at Port of Entry in Epcot. And there's a new Dooney and Burke collection on display in Uptown Jewelers in Magic Kingdom, featuring the fairly obscure characters from shows that were part of Disney Afternoon, a TV block from the 90s. This collection will go on sale June 2nd. There's all our news for this week. Thank you guys so much for listening. Thanks for watching. If you want the news every single day, you can head over to our newsletter. The link to sign up is right under this video in the description, and we get you all the news immediately as it's happening. Thank you guys for listening. Thanks for watching. As always, this is AJ for Disney Food Blog, and we'll see you real soon.